Hey guys, it's Tony. Video time, right? Video time? That's what I'm hearing? Okay, let's do a video.
Today in Nerd History!
As a Midwestern mom from the 1960s might have said, that Hollywood is a real wild place and we don't want you going anywhere near it. And she has a point, because I mean, anything can happen in the filmland Babylon of the far west.
From Big Trouble in Little China starting out as a Buckaroo Banzai sequel to the Nickelodeon movie Snow Day evolving from an episode of The Adventures of Pete and Pete to Cyborg forming out of a sequel to Masters of the Universe.
You've probably seen a lot of movies that the dark arts of Hollywood have secretly transformed into entirely different movies. Here are five times that movies were almost other movies.
Number five, Minority Report.
If you're anything like me, which of course you are, you have an inexplicable fascination with Paul Verhoeven's sci-fi movie Total Recall.
Even though half the movie is just Arnold Schwarzenegger running around with a diaper on his head and pulling enormous glowing golf balls out of his nose.
Ha! It's a great movie! It's great. I love it.
I love it. I love you. I love it.
Somehow, despite its ridiculous premise and creepy robot lady bodysuit containing a creepier robot Arnold, audiences in 1990 also thought it was great, and the studio fast-tracked a sequel to the Philip K. Dick adaptation.
And going back to Dick's short stories for another premise, the Total Recall writing team picked up the rights to Minority Report.
The sequel would have featured Schwarzenegger's character Quaid becoming the head of a security company, using mutant psychics to predict crimes.
But one thing they didn't predict was that the studio would fold just as the movie was entering production.
The production was offloaded to 20th Century Fox, who repackaged it to be a standalone film. And then they had the script stand alone in a closet for about 10 years until Steven Spielberg came around and dusted it off.
Spielberg's Minority Report is actually a pretty good movie, so win-win-ish.
Although he does get a couple of eyeballs yanked out of his head,
I'm just disappointed that nothing comes out of Tom Cruise's perfect schnoz.
Number four, Pirates of the Caribbean.
Before Disney actually owned Lucasfilm, the two still tangoed real close together, their lips brushing as they said, "No, we can't, but we must."
And in the late 90s, the LucasArts Monkey Island games had already ascended to a legendary status. And Lucas put the wheels in motion to bring Guybrush Threepwood and the ghost pirate LeChuck to the big screen.
Though wrapped up in secrecy until pretty recently, the movie actually made great progress in pre-production. They produced tons of concept art, they attached Steven Spielberg, once again, to produce, and he in turn tapped Disney animated veteran Ted Elliott to pen the script. Unfortunately, the project was canceled, but the script did not go down with the ship. In fact, Disney animated veteran Ted Elliott later went on to write
Pirates of the Caribbean, Curse of the Black Pearl. While there's no official record to the rights trading hands, many of the specific similarities speak for themselves.
And before you say,
well, wait a minute, Tony, isn't it possible that both Rod Gilbert of Monkey Island and the Disney team both found inspiration from the same 1987 fantasy novel, On Stranger Tides? I mean, the fourth Pirates movie even has that as a subtitle.
First of all, weird voice, dude. Second of all, no, that's not true, and here's why. Neat and tidy as that would be, in a 2011 interview with Collider, producer Jerry Bruckheimer said that Ted Elliott found the book between shooting the second and third movie.
So it's easier to intuit a simpler explanation for a series of games that feature a blonde dope in a brown vest fighting a ghost pirate with a visit to a voodoo priestess in a swamp and rowing around in a coffin and visiting a city made of sunken ships and so on and so on.
Look at it this way. Maybe we didn't get a Monkey Island movie, sure, but we got a great consolation prize in the form of a Halloween costume that midlife crisis middle-aged dads can wear to prove that they still got it, baby. Ugh, I'm a crazy pirate. That's my impression. It's excellent, I know. Compliment me in the comments below. Thanks.
Number three, Predator.
In the 1980s, there were exactly three strong guys who were in all the strong guy movies, and I know I'm not including Steven Seagal or Dolph Lundgren, but come on, get real. But did you know that Predator at one point almost involved all three of those three strong guys? You probably already know that Jean-Claude Van Damme was supposed to play the Predator itself.
This test footage was being shared around recently, along with a story that no one had told Van Damme that his goofy, bug-eyed red suit alien was just for doing the cloaking device visual effects, and that he spent the whole shoot fuming in his chair between shots.
Maybe because of his bad attitude, or maybe because he couldn't do martial arts while wearing 60 pounds of red rubber foam, he was eventually replaced by Kevin Peter Hall and the classic monster design that we've all come to want to kiss right on the mouth. But you probably didn't know that Dutch, Arnold Schwarzenegger's character, was originally intended to be somebody entirely different.
The sci-fi actioner about a crack team of commandos battling a sci-fi monster from space started as a sequel to, what else? Rocky, of course. Of course. Duh.
Through the 1980s, the Rocky films escalated to a point where the common, tired joke in Hollywood was that Rocky would have to fight an alien in the next movie to keep it moving. And I mean, in defense of the joke, it's really not that out there or absurd, considering that the end of Rocky IV has Burgess Meredith, like, marrying his servant robot. Okay, maybe not like marrying, but like a civil union. The point still stands. They're a thing now. Get over it. They're a power couple in Hollywood.
Screenwriters Jim and John Thomas decided to take the joke and run with it.
Their script, Hunter, was picked up by Fox, and some executive picked it up and gave it the old wiggle-waggle to shake the objectionable elements out of it, and somewhere in the mix, Stallone became Schwarzenegger.
You can still see a lot of the DNA in there. A no-nonsense tough guy hangs out with Carl Weathers until he needs to have a montage sequence to engage in a mano-a-mano fist fight at the climax.
And I'm sure in the original version, instead of being airlifted away, Burgess Meredith and his robo-wife would have shown up in a dune buggy and the three would have just ride off into the sunset.
Number 2, Doctor Strange.
Last year, we finally got Doctor Strange on the big screen, and while Benedict Cumberbatch is cool and while the special effects are great, what if I were to tell you that we already got a Doctor Strange movie in the 1990s, and that comic book legend Jack Kirby did a lot of the concept art for it? And then what if I were also to tell you that the movie is actually kind of terrible? I guess it wouldn't be that surprising, but still.
Before Marvel's quest to reunite all of their characters under the noble banner of the MCU, those guys were dumping out movie rights left and right to make ends meet. This is how we got the embarrassing Captain America and the regrettable Fantastic Four movies of the 1980s.
But we also got our most solid swing at an adaptation from the unlikely horror grindhouse Full Moon Pictures.
Unfortunately for Full Moon, their option on the rights of Doctor Strange expired as they were well underway with the project. But unable to eat the loss, they forged ahead and changed just enough that they could legally release the movie as Dr. Mordred.
And while it's not a great movie, it's still 74 minutes of rather enjoyable schlock. And as a cool bonus, if you're willing to let a technicality slide, Dr. Mordred is actually the first R-rated superhero movie by several years. It's just filled with F-bombs. And I can't say that I blame them. I would probably be saying fuck a lot too if I missed the opportunity to release a major Marvel motion picture.
Number 1, Roger Rabbit.
Who Framed Roger Rabbit and Chinatown are two Hollywood classics that are inexorably linked. One of them scarred children horrifically, and the other was directed by a guy who did, you know, things to children. Ugh. But moving on!
Chinatown featured Jack Nicholson as down-on-his-luck detective Jake Gittes, out to uncover an irrigation conspiracy in 1940s Los Angeles.
The movie was a hit, and though it took a decade and a half, there were eventually plans for two sequels.
Only one was ever produced, The Two Jakes, which saw Jack Nicholson's character out to uncover another mystery, this time based around power and energy. You may recall from Roger Rabbit that a large deal of the political subplot revolves around revolutionizing the transit system.
The rumor, or fact, depending on who you talk to, is that the third Chinatown movie was supposed to revolve around this public works conspiracy.
The name of the movie was also rumored to be Cloverleaf, which actually appears in Roger Rabbit as the name of the transit company.
Chinatown screenwriter Robert Towne claimed that the third movie was actually supposed to be called Gittes vs. Gittes and be about divorce, which is also a big public works project conspiracy. So who do you trust in this crazy mixed up world where there are no clear answers? Forget about it, viewer. It's Chinatown, and also Who Framed Roger Rabbit, and Cloverleaf, and The Two Jakes, and Gittes vs. Gittes. It's all those things. It's, maybe just forget it.